Every great city has its tales, and I've been documenting their stories and people for over 20 years. This is Tales of a City. Australia in the 1950s and 60s was not what you would call an equal society. Women for generations had been relegated to home duties, baby raising and secondary roles in industry. And then came the pill, and it changed everything.
It stops ovulation, so there is no egg.
How effective is it?
If taken as it should be, one pill every day for 3 weeks, it will stop ovulation.
What happens?
100%.
Women not only had control of their bodies, but now sought to enter the male-dominated workforce with a vengeance that would change history. It was in this social climate that a young, determined tornado of a girl named Lucille entered the world of business, little knowing she would help build an industry and advance women in the workplace for a generation.
But unfortunately, I wasn't happy at home with my father. He was a very difficult man to live with. And I wanted to leave home. And in hindsight, when I look back, if it had been today, I would have left home and gone and lived in a flat. But those days, you didn't just leave home and go and live in a flat. So to get out of home, I had to find a husband. That was how it was, kind of thing.
So without hesitation, Lucille boldly went out and found herself a husband and promptly married him. But all was not a bed of roses.
An absolute gambler. I knew I shouldn't marry him. I knew it was wrong.
I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair. I'm gonna wash that man right out of my hair and send him on his way. I'm gonna wave that man right out of my arms. I'm gonna wave that man right out of my arms. I'm gonna wave that man right out of my arms and send him on his way. Don't try to patch it up, tear it up, tear it up. Wash him out, dry him out, push him out.
My father said if I wanted to stay at high school and finish the third year, I had to have a job. So on the first term of that year, I looked for work. And I did an IBM aptitude test, and that got me a job at ETSA. I initially was in the typing pool, And then I went into the computer room and I stayed there until the computer replaced me 5 years later. I did enjoy working at Etsa. They were really lovely people to work for, especially the computer people. They treated us like special people always. What actually happened after 5 years is the computer replaced five departments. And unfortunately, I got married in 1966, and that was the very year that the computers took over all these departments and all the married women were retrenched.
But life was not easy. There was a lot of arguments between my parents, and when I was about 11, it was really only me left at home. My brother had already got married, Lucille had got married and had since divorced, and she decided to open up a shop on Marion Road and asked my mother to manage it, which gave my mother a chance to get out of a difficult situation. So my mother and I left home and we went and worked in the shop for Lucille with my mother managing it. And we were very, very poor. We worked very, very hard, but we were happy. It was like a sense of freedom. The doubt cloud was lifted from us, you could say. And so we worked hard. The shop was open from 8 till 10 o'clock at night, 7 days a week, and we worked. Lucille decided to shut that shop or sell it, and another shop opened further up in the same block, and she started a key punch centre because she had been doing work for IBM and various big companies in data entry, which was a new thing in those days. There was a need for staff to operate data entry machines at the time. Computers were a new thing, big business were getting into it, and there was a need for staff, basically. So I guess all the typists from the typist pools decided to get in to data entry, and anybody that knew how to type could learn it. It was a big thing then. And Lucille decided to open up the business to teach people. She hired some machines from IBM, old card punch machines, and started teaching. Those days was different. You didn't have to have the certificate four in workplace training or anything like that. You taught from knowledge, and it was quite easy to start up something like that. At the time, big business were getting mainframe computers, and they needed people to enter data either onto card or tape to put the information into these computers. We, apart from being a school teaching people, we also employed people that keyed this data in, and would so the companies would give us their invoices or raw documents. We would key the information that they wanted in, and then that would be taken on card or tape to the mainframe computer. And it created a lot of jobs for women, really, because prior to that it was typing pools or secretarial type work, and once you got married you had to leave, generally.
Well, there was, we all hear about the glass ceiling, and it was very much in position then. It is still to a degree today, although there are active moves politically, federally, locally, and not only in the major political arenas, but also in local government. You look at Lucille's an example, Roma Mitchell's an example. Those people who came later, they were intelligent, they were active, they chose to be involved, and they chose to create. A wonderful example of a brilliant woman who took every opportunity for education, which is the key to it all, and went on and did so many things and became a national example. I just think if we had more women in parliaments around the world and fewer blokes, there would be less stoushes, less wars, less blood and guts. No woman wants to see their child destroyed. No woman wants to see their grandchild destroyed.
500 years ago, a genius called Leonardo da Vinci, dreamed of the day man would ride the wind like the albatross and the eagle. To Leonardo, flight was a riddle, an inspiration, a marvel.
In 1979, I joined Ansett Air Freight as their sales manager in Adelaide, and it wasn't that long after that that I fell pregnant and had the baby while I was there. 5.5 weeks after that my little boy was born, they asked me to go to a conference down in Hobart. Stephen was 5.5 weeks old. That was terrible. I was so upset. But when I got back, soon after I got back, they'd been grooming while I was away having the baby someone else for the job, and that was it.
Lucille dusted herself off and went on a fact-finding tour of the United States and caught the eye of one of the decade's biggest icons.
I was upstairs looking for a taxi and I met Morris Diamond, who was a very close friend of Telly. Mm-hmm. And he said, "Taxi, are you from England?" I said, "No, Australia." "Australia, they love Australians. Come over to our hotel and into our suite and have supper with Telly Savalas, Kojak star." Now, I'd never watched TV because I was too busy, but I was on the Broadway in San Francisco and I heard the music. So I went downstairs, and as I was walking down the stairs, this huge entourage of people come through, and this bald man walked past me and I said, "Oh, you must be Yul Brynner." He looked pretty good. He looked good. Anyway, during that period of time that I was there, he called me a hooker. He said, "What are you doing wandering the Broadway on your own in the middle of the night? Are you a hooker?" I went, "No, I'm a businesswoman from Australia." He says, "Same thing, isn't it?" But I think he was upset because I called him Yul Brynner. Anyway. Oh, after that wonderful trip overseas, I came back and I bought myself a Mercedes-Benz. And then just before my birthday, my 31st birthday, I had a very, very bad car accident. I'd caught up with a very good friend of mine called Pask in Melbourne. And we were driving around Keilor trying to find somewhere quiet to have a quiet dinner because we hadn't seen each other for years. He had wanted to marry me. Anyway, a car came speeding around in the middle of the night on the wrong side of the road, on a dead end corner, you know, around the hills, and straight into us. All I did was scream, "We're going to be hit." We couldn't get out of the way because it was blind corner. Next thing I know, we're being pulled out of the car and it rolled several times. It was absolutely written off, his brand new car, Celica, written off, and I ended up in hospital. That was terrible. It was terrible. But it did make me realise that night lying in hospital that I had no one except my staff in three states, and I decided I wanted a baby.
Mum was always working and you know, I had school and stuff, so we kind of just lived and worked together, and like I always helped out doing odd office jobs and stuff, and business-wise she's always been a good guide, which has really helped, because I mean, if I wasn't switched on or didn't have that kind of help, I'd be off trying to figure out what's going on. And she's always been a mentor to other businesswomen, but she's always been a really good mentor to me. And she's helped me along the way, like push to do the certain things that will help me in the future and stuff like that, which is good. She's a business mentor and a mother and a friend. Like three in one. Really good.
In 1985, I joined the Adelaide Festival Centre as their promotions and marketing manager of all their restaurants and everything. It was really exciting. It was fun. The money wasn't as good as previous jobs, but I really enjoyed it. And I put on some very interesting and wonderful events there. They were very happy. My New Year's Eve party was the best they'd ever had. I put together a package of dinner, pre-dinner, dinner and show and late night supper event with the team that were there, or the whole cast that were there for Are You Lonesome Tonight, the Elvis Presley celebration. Yeah, this was a time when these sorts of events had never been offered before, so dinner and show was great. I thought it was normal. Anyway, I went to the girls at Bass because I'd worked in the computer industry, and we created a ticket, and they'd never done it before. So I created something new, and later, about a year later, they actually created the Park Diamond Show, but it was based on what I'd done with the Elvis Presley concert. The reason that I left the Adelaide Festival Centre was because I wanted to put on a reunion for the 10th anniversary of Elvis Presley's death. So I wanted to create the Hi-Fi Club, which was a Coca-Cola event.
Hi! Hi! Welcome to the Hi-Fi Club, kids. It's a program especially for you. It's brand new, and I think the best thing is to settle back, relax, and see how the program goes, and I think it'll explain itself. You have the chance in this program of joining the best teenagers club in the world today, but more about that later. Let's kick off the program to a very bright start. Boom Boom Baby is sung for you by one of Australia's leading teenage talents, the wonderful Margie Mills.
Event. I had wonderful support from Coca-Cola and everything else, and we were giving money to the guide dogs for the blind. But the problem was the Adelaide Festival Centre sold Pepsi, and they didn't want to do a Coca-Cola event. So I said, well, look, I'm going to leave. And I remember Coca-Cola saying it's one of the best and most successful events because we had every television crew there. It was just a fabulous day. In 1986, I created a luncheon club, which eventually became the Australian Executive Women's Network. That was so successful. In 1987, I created the award, which today is the Telstra Business Women's Award.
The Executive Women's Network would propel Lucille into the limelight, inspiring businesswomen nationwide.
Knowing what we want and then going for it is one of the hardest things to achieve. My next guest, at just 21, had saved enough money to start a restaurant and a good business, but lost the lot because of her husband's gambling debts. Not to be deterred, she forged on and has spent the last 25 years building up successful national businesses. 10 years ago, she saw the need for women, especially women, to have assistance in business, and she set up the Australian Executive Women's Network. I'm speaking of Lucille Orr, who joins me this afternoon. Lucille, welcome.
Hi, Kerry.
As I mentioned, you had a rocky start.
Oh, well, rather.
A big rocky start. Mm. You went on for the next few years running businesses. What are your credentials?
Well, basically, I'm self-taught. I only went to third year high school, and I think that's refreshing for other people to know, because you can self-educate yourself along the way. Mm-hmm. But the biggest asset I found that I ever had in business was not being afraid to ask people for help, because you can learn more quickly from mentors, from people that have got experience, mm-hmm. and you can also gain a lot by asking for support financially or in other ways. So I got free office space, I got the use of free computer equipment when I had my computer business, I got money. You know, I just asked for it.
Just asking, just literally.
Literally just asking.
Having the will to do business, and also not only the will, having to support yourself.
Well, that was another thing. Not only myself, but after my marriage broke up, I ended up with my mother and 11-year-old sister to support as well, mm-hmm. in a one-bedroom flat. And at that time, I had $20 in my purse. So I think the biggest lesson I learnt, Kerry, was that if you lose everything, you've got nothing to lose if you start again.
Okay.
So sometimes money can be fun. When you haven't got it.
When you haven't got it, fine. As I mentioned, 1986, you set up the Australian Women's Network.
Yes. Now, the reason I did that was when I had a national business in three states and I was travelling between the branches, I used to find it very lonely, particularly back in the 60s and 70s, mm. when I was only really doing business with men. Mm. And I really wished that I'd meet more women in business, and they weren't around. So I felt that if we had a women's network, particularly a business-type network, women could share and learn from one another and help each other in business.
But there'd be a lot of criticism. Why do women need a network? I mean, come on.
Men have had them for years, Kerry.
Indeed.
You know, they have. So it's our turn now, and what's actually happening is we're learning that profit's not a dirty word, and that we're learning from each other's experience in business. It's great.
Mm. So how does a network for women work?
Okay, well, we do invite men to get involved, and we have got male members, so we're not exclusively just for women, but what we are finding is that by having lunches and meetings and workshops and seminars, we can share the information and learn from each other. And that's what we're doing, and now I've brought out an audio magazine, mm-hmm. to be able to bring that to the public as well.
What's the biggest single mistake that women make in business? Well, you know, we hear about the glass ceiling. Is that a glass ceiling we impose on ourselves?
In a lot of cases, I believe we do. And the reason I say that, and a lot of women would criticise the fact that I would say that, is because often we don't want to get out of the comfort zone of a job we've had for a long time. We've worked our way up, we get to a certain level, and we've been there a long time. We're going to lose superannuation benefits and a lot of other benefits by leaving. So we let this glass ceiling hold us back. And the glass ceiling is often because there's a political reason why the organisation can't let you go any further, or there could be a male boss holding you back, or even a female.
Mm, indeed.
So what we have to do is get out of the job and go somewhere else, that's all.
Well, how do females react to other females in a job situation?
In a lot of cases, in the early days...
You can't, you know, it's a very big generalisation, but...
Well, it is, but in the early days, women used to hold on to knowledge thinking it was power and didn't share it, which was really holding them back. Mm-hmm. Today, the opposite's happening. I'm actually getting asked to go into organisations and teach supervisors to think like managers so that women managers can push themselves up. So the best lesson that women can learn in business is to create a network within the business for themselves, because that's what the men have done.
Because sometimes people, whether it's a male or female, can be afraid of teaching somebody else on the up how good and easy things are because they'll be done out of a job.
Well, you see, that's the way women think, but it's not true, because the more you can delegate to other people, the higher you can be pushed up by those people to the high corporate top of the ladder. So it is important for us to pass on everything we know and be confident that if we have good people underneath us, we can go right to the top.
Well, to be successful, you have to surround yourself, and to be powerful and successful, surround yourself by people who are very good at what they do.
Absolutely.
And make you shine, if you want to be purely selfish about it. So what advice do you have for women who perhaps are homemakers at the moment? They need to or want to strive in the workforce. What would you suggest?
Well, the first thing I'd suggest is I really would like them to buy my book, because How to Ask for What You Want and Get It is a book that I wrote which includes a lot of information about what I've done to become successful and others.
One woman who was inspired by Lucille's business mentoring now leads her own Sydney-based financial accounting service.
Well, back in the mid-90s, actually, we met when she came to Sydney from Adelaide and, you know, settled down in this town. And, you know, she started her Australian Executive Women's Network in Sydney. Well, it was in Adelaide, but she brought it to Sydney. And I met her. I can't remember who told me about her, but I found out what she's doing, and I wanted to be part of the women's network because I was starting my business. And you know, being a woman, it was, you know, the normal thing to kind of do. You know, the next thing you would do is support other women and get supported by other women. You know, I was 28 years old and I needed support and mentors. And I felt like when I first time I met Lucille, I felt like she is someone who would be like, you know, a business mentor, businesswoman mentor for me. She's approachable, she's not a snob, she's down to earth. She would share with you everything that she knows, and she doesn't kind of withhold and work things out. Like, she's not a calculating person. What you see is what you get, and I like that about a person, because that's how I am, to explain it. She's not stuck in her own thinking. So, you know, since I've known her, she reinvents herself.
Authoring multiple books has reinforced Lucille's legacy in business affairs.
The concept of my books are always based on true life stories. So if those people can do it, so can you.
Now, in the books, you pick some very interesting topics, and obviously chapter by chapter it sort of helps you grow and become more enthusiastic. Have you got a favourite part of the book?
The most powerful section in the whole book is where I talk about how to get corporate sponsorships, but I really wrote the book to help everybody. There's a lot of unemployed people out there, particularly in country areas, that perhaps haven't thought about the fact that they had a gift as a child. So I go right back to childhood. Sue, what was it that you were born with that you loved to do? In my case, it was talking, and I got in trouble for it. So now I've decided, why not get paid for it? So that's what I'm doing.
Good idea.
So I go back to childhood, I say, what is it that you wanted to do? And we develop the idea of empowering ourselves to do that, coupled with the education that we've had, perhaps the work experience we've had. I teach people through the book on how to break glass ceilings in the work environment, how to perhaps start a new department or a new product for your company, how to actually become the boss, how to apply for a job, even though they might say there's a qualification that you haven't got. If you feel you're experienced, apply for it anyway. How to turn the corporate world into a stage, and you're the star. How to win in sales. How to start your own business, your own small business. And of course, more importantly, how to gain those important sponsors to support you, whether it be cars, money, computers. Doesn't matter what it is, ask for it. I've had all these things given to me only because I wasn't too shy to ask.
It's just out there to share with people how to ask for what you want and get it. And that's who she is. I think a lot of women looked up to her, and a lot of women wanted that support. And I remember there was this, the wife of a retired general from Perth, and she looked up to her. And you know, I spoke with her and I met that woman, and you wouldn't think that someone like her, with that standing, and she carried herself, that she also looked up to Lucille. So it does say something. Other business networks, other business women's networks, or even other business networks would not be doing what she was doing 20 years ago for the amount of money that they were charging. Now there are businesswomen setting up their own networks and charging different levels. You want interaction with me, it's like, you know, $500 a month. You just want to come to the dinners, it's $100 a month. You know what I mean? So, you know, but Lucille was like, $100 a month for all this support. For her, it was more than the money. It was more about supporting other women. She loves to support other businesswomen, and she is genuine about it.
In 2015, while I was very happy with my career, I was extremely overweight. My blood pressure was through the roof. The doctors couldn't get it down. I was very frustrated and very miserable. So I decided that I needed to do something, and I joined Curbs. And I had to set a goal. So I set a goal to speak on the Las Vegas stage and wear this suit. And I did it. I got into size 14 in a very short time, and they've been wonderful.
She just came in the door one day and asked me for help, to help her lose weight and to gain her life back and just get fit and healthy. Look, I've noticed she's a very dynamic person and she's very knowledgeable. I know that she will lose her weight, and I've told her from day one, she's come in with the positive attitude, I want to get this done. And I've told her, I know you're going to do it, and we're helping her. Through Curves, we're helping her reach her goals. I'm a firm believer that knowledge is power. With my business, I wanted to empower women. I wanted to give the women knowledge to help themselves. There's only women allowed inside. Our motto is no mirrors, no men. And we're all about strengthening women from the inside to outside.
At this late stage in your life, looking back, do you have any regrets?
No, because I wouldn't change anything. I've had the most exciting life. I've worked hard, I've done a lot of things. No, and I'm still going. The most important thing is just to be healthy and keep going forever.
Would you have any advice for young women entering the workforce and entering business in 2016?
Be true to yourself. Don't listen to others. Don't tell too many people what you want to do if you want to go into business. Believe in your intuition, follow it, and you'll get there.
Over 40 years, Lucille Orr has weathered the fortunes of Australian business, inspired and mentored thousands, and has established a legacy that until now remained unrecognised. But if I'm not mistaken, the world hasn't heard the last of Lucille Orr.